Not enough. No. We don't have enough personal protective equipment. No gowns, no test kits, no masks. So we've started to use scarves, bandanas, and cut-up gowns to use as masks. Our ICUs are overflowing. We're working 14 hours a day, but it's not enough. My 93-year-old mother worries about me every day. The doctor fights the family man in me every day. My colleagues have kindly taken me out of the ICU because my age puts me in the high-risk category. We hope we don't fail your generation. I hope this ends soon. But if it doesn't, I'm here to take care of you.
We all knew this was starting to get serious. But nobody knew the real extent of it. Would we ever be faced with such unprecedented times? Full of darkness and danger they were. And sometimes you didn't want them to end. Because how could the end be happy? How could the world go back to what it was when so much bad had happened? But in the end, this is just a passing, this shadow. All darkness must pass. A new day will come, and the sun will shine clearer. I know now that there were many doctors who could have turned their backs and just walked away, but they didn't. They had hope. They kept going because they knew that there was this one thing worth fighting for. And they continued to fight. There is good in this world, and it is worth fighting for. I hope this ends soon, but if it does not, I'm here with you.
Hello everyone, good day. I hope you are doing well. Today we will be learning about how to properly dispose of our PPE. I should have probably introduced myself before. My name is Mary MacDonald. I am the ER nursing supervisor here at Queen's General Hospital in Liverpool, Nova Scotia. We are a small community of 2,600 people, but we do have a large elderly population that we want to keep safe, as well as our friends and our family. So, one of the things that we can do as healthcare professionals is learn how to properly dispose of our PPE, our personal protective equipment, and that is what I'm going to show you how to do today. The first thing you want to do is remove your outer gloves. Then you will take your hands, put them on the headband of your face shield, and remove your face shield. Then you will take your gown, roll it in onto itself, and dispose. That is how you safely dispose of your PPE. This will help stop the spread of COVID-19. That's what we want to do. We don't want any more of our friends and families to get it. This is what I propose that we do. I hope this ends soon, but if it doesn't, I'm here to take care of you.
So I realized Corona is like a spouse. Initially, you try to control it, but then you realize you cannot, and then you learn to live with it and adjust with it all your life. It's like the bank teller was arrested for taking money home, and he was like, "Arey sahib, you only told me to work from home." Sorry, I have a phone call. Sorry. Anjali. No. No, it's not good, baby. I don't know how these guys are working. I really don't know how they are putting their lives in front of everybody every day. I hope that somebody is there to take care of them like they are taking care of everybody. And I hope we realize how important these frontliners are to our lives. They are putting their lives there in front of COVID-19 and a human life every day so that we are safe. I salute you, frontliners, and I hold you in the highest regard. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So where was I? I hope this ends soon, but if it doesn't, I am here to take care of you guys.
It takes nerves of steel to be part of one of the largest armies in the world. Putting your life on the line is a basic job description, and I salute these heroes as they relentlessly work towards a healthy nation. But there is someone very significant who is part of the lives of these soldiers, and they ensure that the soldiers' unflinching love for the nation is not hindered, and that is us, the wives of the soldiers of the army. The army is not a job, but a way of life. We not only shoulder the responsibility of our husbands, the soldiers, but also the responsibility of our children, the elderly in the family, and the welfare of the community. Add to this equation the onerous task of living a life of pride in the event that one of us loses a partner in combat. But again, we will stand by our husbands as they are called to the front, this time not only putting their lives at risk, but the lives of our family members too. It takes raw courage to accept and imbibe in behavior that your husband loves the nation a lot more than he loves you or your family. Today, I want to salute these wives of the army. You know that you are the backbone of this very respected community. And on behalf of the army family, I would like to say, I hope this ends soon, but if it doesn't, I am here to care for you.
After the whole day of work, battling COVID-19 amongst the homeless and refugees, I come home with a very heavy heart and a sad feeling. You know, I do not want to feel what I was feeling, like helpless. On one side, the health officials state that you have to stay at home, maintain physical distancing, sanitize and wash your hands. The disparity. How are my patients supposed to abide to them when they do not even have a home? Do they live on the streets and are deprived of necessities like food and shelter? And because of the lack of access to the most basic needs, they are at such a high risk of illness and even death. I'm unable to sleep at night. You know that feeling of helplessness? It's those eyes. The hopeful eyes make me feel socially accountable and connected. I will continue my fight to give them the ability to self-isolate in a dignified manner. Our work on the front doesn't end. We are constantly working, worrying, researching, and fighting once we go home. I just hope this ends soon. But if it doesn't, I am here to take care.
Y'all, this is Patsy the Patriotic Potato of YouTube fame, and I'm coming to you from Phoenix, Arizona, taping this message to tell all the frontline workers everywhere that I wear a mask because I care. And I just want to thank all of y'all for everything you're doing and all the sacrifices you are making. Special shout out to my human sister, Wendy, out of New York City, New York Cornell Wild Hospital, because she was on the COVID team, helping protect everyone, intubate everyone. So special shout out to my sister, Wendy, and everyone else who's been doing their due diligence, all the grocery workers, all the firemen, all the policemen all over the world, all the healthcare workers, all the maintenance people in the hospital. Don't forget about them. Anywho, I hope this ends soon, but if it doesn't, I'm here to take care of you. Love you. Mwah.
I just finished my 13-hour shift. I stay away from my family. And I feel so isolated from everyone. And I'm tired of calling family members every day to let them know that their loved ones are not going to make it. And some of them are like, no, don't give up. Please keep trying. He's not meant to die. We had a patient who was diabetic and was tested COVID positive. And he was given less than a week's time, but his wife didn't want him to die. So we moved him from comfort care to the ICU so we could intubate him. And I'm like, that's somebody else's spot for a rent. And as a nurse, I've never had to think that way before, ever. I don't know what this virus is doing to me. I'm scared. I don't want to play God. I just want to do my job. And I'm trying everything to maintain my mental sanity. Yoga, meditation, counseling, everything. I just hope all this ends soon. But if it doesn't, I'm here to take care of you.
Hi, Ma. Sorry I couldn't answer your call earlier. No, Ma, I'm not sick. I'm just tired. It's such long shifts. We're running short on staff. Two more nurses have gone down with the COVID illness, and four more of my patients have tested positive. And the most difficult thing, Ma, is to tell them that they're in quarantine, that they can't go home to their families and spend time with them. Oh, Ma, please don't cry. Please, 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 Ma. I know you know how that feels. And just like I can't come home to you. Yes, Ma. But the most important thing right now is that you and Dad stay home and stay safe. And I am here to look after my patients. Yeah, I hope this ends soon, but while it lasts, I'm here for you. Yes, Ma, I promise I look after myself.
As the COVID-19 pandemic struck my city, my school, like several others, decided to go online. Over the last 9 weeks, my workday has started like any other in the past. At 7:30 a.m., with a smile and a good morning, except I've done it from the comfort of my home, at this desk with this background. At a time when the pandemic is physically taking over the world, where our cities are turning into danger zones, there are people who are actually stepping out to grow our food, to heal our ill, to clean our streets. And I'm in the comfort of my home. Am I even a frontline worker? A glance back at my 9 weeks And yes, I am a frontline worker. Every teacher on this planet right now is a frontline worker. We're working on the emotional frontline of this pandemic. Overnight, as our realities changed, we have had one singular focus: to keep our students secure. As we navigated new structures, we tried and maintained their structures. And where we couldn't, we helped them engage with the new realities of their life. As we juggled our own families, we taught them ways in which they could love theirs. As we battled our own fears and anxieties, we told them it was okay for them to be scared and anxious. We taught them the value of laughter and hope and faith, and showed them that even if it seems like the world is crumbling, they are cared for. Our children are our promise to tomorrow, and us teachers, we will do whatever it takes to nurture that promise, no matter how hard things get. And to my kids, I say, I hope this ends soon, but if it doesn't, I'm here to take care of you.
I was already immersed in the battle against COVID-19. It was something that I'd never seen before. People were deteriorating so fast. Fine one day, and 2 days later, they were in intensive care. It was the rapid progression of the disease. Now it's rampant in our community. I had to do something. And going without an N95 mask was not feasible anymore. This was an exception to the rule. I had to do all I could to help out. I thought so hard. I am a Sikh, and my beard is so important to my identity. Kesh, which is a pillar of our faith, grown naturally to reflect the perfection of God's creation. And then there's another pillar, Seva, which means service to our fellow men. I had to cut it off. It was a difficult decision, and absolutely necessary though. Now, members of healthcare have accepted the new reality and have to come to terms with this. I believe that there will be a second wave, and I don't foresee anything changing soon. We are here for the long haul. There is, however, light at the end of the tunnel, but it's still pretty far away. I hope this ends soon, but if it doesn't, I am here to take care of you.
The room was dimly lit when my team hustled to collect all the possible instruments. The makeshift theater looks almost nearly complete now. My assistant even managed to get a sterile gown for me when I took my wash. I know all my steps. I've done it over and over hundreds of times. I've performed this in my city, and it's almost my muscle memory. But in times of chaos like this, mistakes are truly unpardonable. This anxiety, this nervousness is for real. It feels like as if it's my first day. COVID-19 has hit us really, really bad. More so in this particular village. Lack of transportation does not even give us the facility or luxury to shift the patient to a decent hospital. But if I delay this procedure just for the lack of space, this person lay in front of me would not survive. Would never survive. You can do it as you have always done, because Allah is with you. So team, is the light ready? Is the camera checked? Then I guess it's time for action. And hey, by the way, this is the day of a frontliner every day. A new performance every single day, every single case. I really hope this ends very soon. But if it doesn't, I'm there to take care of you.
Good morning, madam. Very hot today. Which country, madam? Oh, you America. A big country. Trump. Eppada gulla renne. Me from Kerala, madam. Small place in India. My name is Sada Lakshmi Kumari. You can call me Lakshmi in short. Why am I telling you my name? Too much problem, madam. Corona, corona, everywhere corona. Big corona, small corona, medium corona, are you? Too much problem. Morning is 7 o'clock, madam. Evening is 6 o'clock. Standing at the airport. No flight, no passenger, no money. Why am I telling you my story, madam? Husband got a corona, madam. In Kerala. No money, no doctor, no medicine. Driving, sending money. Small baby, madam. Living with a mummy. Why am I telling you my story, madam? You first customer, madam. First customer. Don't call any other taxi, madam. I take you anywhere. Give me Mr. God. I take you Burj Khalifa, Emirates Towers, Madinata. Full Dubai, I know, madam. I hope this finishes fast, madam. If it does not, madam, I am there to take care of you, madam. Lakshmi.